आप लोगों को चांस नहीं मिला, आपने बहुत ठीक चला है ना, नेक्स्ट टाइम फिर से मिलेगा आपको, आई एम जस्ट पुलिंग योर लेग, ठीक है ना। Series speaker, Hari Kiran Vadlamani ji. Fellows of the Institute, members of the Gandhi Winter School, members of the, what academy are you? Financial Academy? Exactly, colleagues from HP University and friends. I'm really delighted today to welcome in our midst Hari Kiran ji. Let me tell you a little story about him first. All of you must have heard about a book called Urban Naxals, yes, by a man called Vivek Agnihotri. Yeah. The most wonderful thing about the book is the foreword to the book, which I have written, but that's a joke. That's a joke. Actually, what I want to tell you is it's one of India's number one bestsellers. I don't know if you know that. And it's based on the making of a film called Buddha and the Traffic Jam. You may or may not have seen the film, and you may or may not like the film. But the book is extraordinary. Why? Not so much for its political context, but it tells the story of how a person whose life had gone right down to rock bottom. As he said, he was a Bollywood dropout, right? Kicked out, a persona non grata, how he rebuilt his life. And in the process, rediscovered India. And this is a marketing success, if you know anything about publishing. And it's a book published by a completely unknown and new publishing house, Garuda. And it is, I think the book has been launched or spoken about in a book tour which comprises, I think, more than 50 countries all over the world and all over India. And just this morning, I saw a photo of the author, Vivek Agnihotri, with Shri Shri Ravi Shankar. And he shared the stage with him. And if you've been to the Art of Living Ashram in Bangalore, there are 50,000 people there. Okay? But what people don't know is that the man who is responsible for that book is actually Kiran. What happened is Kiran ji told Vivek ji that, why don't you write a book sharing your experience about how you made this film on a shoestring budget of 2 crores? out of which the financier backed out. And he had only 50 lakhs left in the end, which is usually peanuts. And if you read the book, you'll see how Anupam Kher acted for free. It's a great book to read, okay? And don't read the preface. I'm not trying to forward. I'm not trying to promote that forward. But you see, so the film was made, and that seemed to be the end of the story, heroic though it was. And then Kiranji told Vivekji that, look, why don't you write a book? And Vivekji said, I've never written a book. I know nothing about writing. I'm a filmmaker. He said, I will send you to Goa, to one of the best hotels there, the Hyatt, which is a beautiful property because I've stayed there, for a conclave. The last part of which was the India Ideas, India Thought Conclave, again, Kiran reorganized. And I'll tell you that story also in a minute. I just want to give you a feel of how creative he is. So he said, look, I'll send you there. He sent him there for 3 weeks, and the book started like that. So Kiranji has seeded so many such ideas, and that thought conclave was something he and I thought about in a foreign land. We were sitting together after a conference, and he said, look, I want to talk to you, I have this idea I want to discuss. And then this incredible thought conclave happened, which had such great speakers. You know, I don't want to go into the details. But the thing I wanted to explain to you is that Kiranji is not only an entrepreneur, an angel investor, but he's a creative genius. He comes up with such incredible ideas. In fact, we were driving together one day in Singapore, and he saw all these cranes. You know, whenever you have a building, there's a crane. But the crane is also a bird, as you know, right? And there's a joke about Singapore, that the national bird of Singapore is the crane. Not the bird, the crane, but that, you know, the thing they used to build, these tall buildings. So he wanted to choreograph a dance of the cranes at Panjum, where was it? Yeah? Pagar. So it's an incredible idea. And one last thing, I don't know whether it happened, I don't think it did. So thinking big, making things happen. One last example I want to give you and then hand it over to him. You know, I was supposed to speak in Singapore. He had organized a talk by me at you know, one of the premier strategic studies institute, which is affiliated with the Nanyang Technological University, NTU. And for some reason, there was some problem with the tickets, because I was actually flying out on the day I was supposed to give a talk. I was in Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur at that time. And I called him up and I said, you know, Kiranji, I just discovered that the ticketing is all wrong. So he sent me a clip from an obscure film. Which film was it? But the film, basically, usme kya hota hai? Aap thoda sa reel dekhte hain, it's about some person lost in space, okay? And then all this control room mein log baithe hain. And then they said, failure is not an option. So in this world, failure is not an option. So I have learned a lot from him. I've been inspired by him myself. And as to his official introduction, I want to tell you, he founded the Indic Academy a couple of years ago. And through this, he has seeded so many wonderful projects. He'll tell you about some of them. And his goal is to make India one of the top global soft power countries in the world by 2020. And to this end, he has 2025. Okay, he's 2030. Chalo, we'll give him another few years. Because nobody else is thinking about these things. And the big thing is, don't go with a begging bowl to government. Do it yourself. That is his motto. Because we have enough resources, enough intelligence, enough motivated people, enough power of our own to do these things. We have a great civilization, the world is dying to know about it, they want authentic experiences, they want to understand the meaning of ritual. It's our job to offer it to them in a way, on a platform which is meaningful. So he's also founded the Indian Book Club, and they've had at least 200 meetings all over the world. New authors have been created, new books have been launched, and people who never thought they could write books have written books. He has also promoted. Videos on Indian culture, somebody in the audience has made 108 of them. We want to celebrate that. He started Indica. Okay, please stand up, take a bow. She has also been inspired by Kiranji. So 100 short videos on different aspects of Indian culture have been made by Gayatri Iyer. And like that, he's a part owner of Swarajya magazine. He has funded so many bottles, so many individuals, so many scholars. If you have a good idea, you can send it to him. If it's going to fly, he'll fund it. So, and Indic Academy I mentioned, Indic Book Club I mentioned, Indica, Indic Pictures, and there's at least 15 such organizations that he has seeded. And his last, I think one of his greatest, is the idea of creating an inter-university center in Coimbatore for leadership training. And he's building 30 villas there. Mm-hmm. With state of the art, I don't think we'll have such glitches there. Mike Chal Raya, Spotlight, Hackney. And it's a combination of, you know, the idea of the Aspen Institute, the Esalen Institute, and so forth. But it's to create a new leadership for India. You see, because we need leadership for the next stage of the Indian Renaissance. Okay? It needs leadership. Young people have, so I'm so glad young people have come to listen to him today. And I'm so happy that you're here. And yesterday, he told me something. I'm going to share it with him. I know he'll be upset with all of you because he's a very modest person. I'm saying all this because he never says all this. Nobody knows this about him. There are hundreds of things. The secret mover is Kiranji. You wouldn't know. But yesterday he told me he's taken a vow to establish 108 statues of Shankaracharya. The first one will be in Tirunelveli in Tamil Nadu on the 18th of January. If you happen to be in Tamil Nadu, please come and see its installation in Tirunelveli. Okay? And the last thing I want to say is that one of our attempts has been to, transform the IIAS, which was like an ivory tower, you know, scholars working deeply in their own studies, you know, and creating research and books. But hardly anybody knew about our books. Even now we have stacks of books unsold. So I thought that we should create new platforms so that the institute can connect with society and our work should be better known. This is, by the way, a part of our mandate. MOA mein likha hai. कि जो काम हो रहा है हमारे यहाँ वो दूसरे लोग तक पहुँचाया जाए और दूसरे लोग भी हमारे संपर्क में आए और देश में जो जो चीज़ें हो रही हैं वो हमारे काम से प्रोत्साहित हो लेकिन ये ज़्यादातर हो नहीं रहा था तो हमने सोचा कि हमारी लेक्चर सीरीज तो थी विजिटिंग स्कॉलर्स की उसके अलावा हमने 2-3 लेक्चर सीरीज शुरू की हैं और हमारी जो एपेक्स लेक्चर सीरीज है जो राधा कृष्ण मेमोरियल है और टैगोर मेमोरियल और फिर विजिटिंग स्कॉलर्स है और उसके बीच में बहुत कम है तो आई एम हैप्पी टू से दैट वी हैव रिसीव्ड अप्रूवल फॉर सम न्यू आइडियाज यू नो वन ऑफ देम वाज लॉरिएट इन रेजिडेंस नॉट नेसेसरी नोबेल लॉरिएट इट कैन बी अ ज्ञानपीठ अवार्ड विनर अ पुलित्ज़र प्राइज विनर अ मैन बुकर कोई भी ग्रेट अवार्ड हो देयर मेनी साइंस प्राइजेस इन द वर्ल्ड दे शुड स्पेंड अ वीक इन IIAS इंटरैक्ट विद ऑल ऑफ अस प्रोड्यूस सम वर्क Then we had another scheme, the Best Minds of India scheme, that we have not yet activated. The Best Minds means minds like Shankara, of the past, or minds of today, whom we consider the best minds of India, like Narayanamurthy, for example, who started Infosys. You know, so we want that kind of Best Minds series. And then we have the Distinguished Lecture series of IIAS. And we are inaugurating it today. So it's a very special day for me, Kiranji. And we are inaugurating it with Kiranji's talk. And this is a talk about how to leverage India's soft power in a changing global environment. All yours, Kiranji.
Inviting me for this lecture, the inaugural lecture. standing here in such a venerable institution, started by one of the greatest philosophers of contemporary India, is indeed a great honor. Thank you. Thank you very much. My journey into specifically soft power and the moment of epiphany, so to speak, happened over a dining table. This was way back in 2005 when I was going to London very often for an arbitration case that I was handling. And I was sitting in a restaurant set up by Vinit Bhatia, it's called Rasoi. And I was the only Indian there in that restaurant. And they were all Britishers and other nationalities. And one of the most amazing experiences that I had, an Indian meal that I had, was there. What I realized at that point in time, and the way the food was cooked, it's what is known as molecular gastronomy, modernistic cuisine, fusion. But basically it was just Indian food, but cooked completely differently, presented even completely more differently. That was just, at that time, I felt that what we need to do when we are presenting our culture to global audiences was to retain the authenticity, but constantly evolve, constantly get into new forms while the grammar remains the same. That was the time when I realized that there are so many facets of our culture that if we apply our mind, it's not a simple case of fusion, but if we apply our mind, go back to the basics, deconstruct it, and then reconstruct it and present it back, then we would surely be capturing the minds of the global audiences. That was the moment of epiphany and my journey into this passion for soft power. So it's interesting that I'm showing you a 2-minute video of another great cook, Grant Achatz. He's number one in US of A in Chicago. It's a very, very interesting thing. I would like you to watch it. It just takes a while, one or 2 minutes, and then you'll understand what I mean.
चार्जिंग हो रही है didn't realize that my feet was in Shimla also. My feet was in Shimla also.
Oh yes, my feet is everywhere.
So anyway, we just continue this conversation. So can anybody tell me what you just saw there? Any idea what's happening there? Philosophically.
Unorganized.
They're creating some new culinary marvel and
yes.
doing it in front of everybody.
Yes, but
something out of nothing, literally. That powder.
No. It's like the powder, yes.
Yeah, so that made into a pie or whatever that was. Something out of just pure powder.
My take on this, you can go back. My take on this is we all hear the phrase thinking out of the box.
Oh.
Right? We all hear that phrase. What does it mean? This is one very good example of thinking out of the box. There's an interview with Grant Akkad where he talks about creating desserts, new forms of desserts. And then he said that the plate was limiting me, right? It was limiting my creativity. So I said, why can't we eat on the table? Right? Why should a dessert be in a plate, but why can't we create it on the table? So think of it that way, that he's actually thinking out of the box. And he's removed the need for a plate, right? This idea, when I saw it, it gave me two ideas. One, think of tourism not as an inward journey of a person, but think of tourism of any non-Indian who is consuming some part of our culture, be it a meal, be it doing yoga, be it doing meditation, be it watching a performance, anything that he's doing, if he's sitting in New York and he's watching something or a film, he's actually a tourist. He's actually consuming our culture. So if you think of it, when we talk about tourism, we only measure tourism by the number of people coming into the country. Right? Similarly, when Modiji talks about demographic dividend, he talks about people and skill development and all that, we have to, and we talk about the youth and talk about the constituency, we have to think of the global NRIs as our own. The global NRIs as our own, and not limited within the boundaries of our country, but they're all ambassadors with whom, through whom, we can sell, market our culture. So these are the two things that I picked up when I watched this video. A little bit of marketing talk about what I'm doing currently. I'm the founder of Indic Academy. So what we are trying to do here is trying to build a intellectual, cultural, and spiritual renaissance. So it's a combination of all the three, because our culture, the ideas in our culture flow through from an intellectual thought into a dance form, into a painting form, into a spiritual form. A simple example is if you think of a mudra, for example. A mudra is a health. It's a health thing. Mudra is, you can teach Vedanta through mudra, or you can also do a dance performance with mudra. You see how it translates into intellectual, cultural, and spiritual aspects. So when we think of Renaissance in India, we have to think of the entire spectrum, because that is our culture. Now, I look at it at two angles, at the individual level, at the macro level. At the individual level, we think of, first and foremost, making an individual discover his self, what his potential is, what his aptitude is, what his attitude is. Then making work in a selfless manner, the nishkam karma that we talk about in our Gita, and become a social entrepreneur, and then eventually look at discovering his own true self, which is the self-realization. In terms of our dharma itself, in terms of our culture, in terms of civilization thought, the three aspects that we need to do, which is protection, because there's a lot of distortions, a lot of attacks, then there's preservation, then there's promotion. We have six centers. We have established a center for inter-university for Indian systems. We have a center for writers, soft power, spirituality, social entrepreneurs, and women. These are our functions. We conduct courses, grants, platforms, networks, and collaborations. So we're trying to build an ecosystem wherein we're consciously cultivating relationships with various institutions and creating this collaborative framework. So it's 3 years old, 3.5 years old. We've done more than 200 events. We have 25 chapters. We are the only platform for book launches around the world. We have granted more than 50 scholarships, collaborations, workshops. We have created these platforms. And we have some virtual networks. So this is briefly about what Indic Academy is up to. Now, we all know that, you know, Saudi Arabia has got oil. That's Indonesia has got coal, Australia has got coal, a lot of African countries have natural resources. But if you look at India, what does India have? Right? The famous dialogue, mere paas maa hai, right? It's like, mere paas culture. Right? If you look at it, India is having culture, and that culture can be leveraged. So if you look at this table, you have two concepts, you have a hard power and you have a soft power. In the hard power, you have the military and economic. And you see some countries have the economic. For example, Germany is not a military power, it's an economic power. Japan also like that. US straddles both, China straddles both. We, unfortunately, don't have the economic and military power. But surely, we have the cultural power. And cultural power, the definition by Joseph Nye, the soft power is at three axes: culture, political values, and foreign policy. Obviously, we are not aggressive like US and China is, and that's our strength. Meanwhile, what's happening around the world? What are the trends? Cultural experiences and craft. So entire millennials around the world, there's a pushback and there's what is known as conscious consumption. That they don't want to consume anything which is made by large companies. Whatever they're consuming, they want to consume in a manner that is saving a village somewhere, saving something somewhere, and handmade. Tourism also, like I mentioned to you, is mostly about not visiting a place, looking at a monument, looking at the beach. Those days are gone. Today, anybody travels, they travel for a cultural experience. They don't travel to see a place. In terms of care and consciousness, I combine them both and try to bring in a bit of Vedantic flavor in terms of Jiva Jagat Ishvara. So at the individual level, we all know about yoga and meditation and Ayurveda, which is a big trend globally. Then we also know about environment and how we are all conscious about environment. And the last but not least is that the biggest growing religion today is what we call as spiritual but not religious. That's the biggest growing religion. Where does India score? On all these four things that I talked about, India scores very high. In terms of, obviously US doesn't have all these things, being a recent country. And China has cultural experiences per graph. So what is this all about? Why are we, why are we talking about soft power, and why are we talking about these kind of... It is not for an experience. When we set up ICCR way back in the 50s, it was about promoting our culture. But it was not about deriving economic value out of it. What we are trying to do now is saying that, look, soft power is not just about the emotional experience, but it is actually about the economic value chain behind that experience. So how do we translate it to something in the back end that there is a somebody who is prosperous with it, person in Varanasi, some person somewhere else is making money on it. So what kind of strategies that we can talk about in terms of devising this soft power and leveraging our soft power? These are some of the things that we are pursuing, and I will deal with them individually. We have just set up a center for soft power, and we are in the process of establishing NICE, which is a network of Indian cultural entrepreneurs. We're looking at developing a dashboard, establishing a soft power fund, liaising with the government to look at the entrepreneurs outside of India and see whether they can get financing, and developing greenback voters cluster theory and looking at that. So this is a think tank focused on soft power. We have so far held 9 roundtables across different verticals: Ayurveda, art, craft and design, yoga, spirituality, cuisine, cinema. So we have these verticals. We are doing a conference on soft power in Delhi from 17th to 19th. We're doing one more conference in January. But more importantly, this is the events part, but what we are looking at is actual research. So looking at how our culture is being consumed in Brazil, for example, what's happening in Russia. So there are some countries which resonate and absorb our culture, like most of us don't know in Argentina and South America. I don't know whether you've seen the videos of Shri, addressing a gathering of more than 2 lakh people in his dancing and all that. So country-wise research is what we are setting out to do. NICE is a network, a Section 8 company. I don't know whether you're aware of NASCOM, which is basically a trade body for software. So what we're trying to do is set up a similar vehicle for culture. So it covers all the verticals. Look at trade shows, exhibitions, and conferences. More importantly, I don't know whether you're aware, McKinsey worked with NASCOM to prepare a business plan way back in 2000. We are also trying to do a similar thing, create a business plan and see how best we can work across all these verticals. I don't know whether you are aware of dashboards and how, if you look at any election time now or tomorrow, the results will, so they'll say, okay, this constituency, this is happening, this is what's happening. This is a dashboard, right? So imagine a dashboard wherein, if you have a dashboard of Australia, for example, and click on Adelaide, immediately you will have information on how many restaurants are there in Adelaide, what kind of restaurants are there, how many handicraft shops are there, what kind of Ayurveda books are available, stores are available. So you will have that kind of a framework. What happens is, if you have this and develop this on a real-time basis, then you can also make policy decisions, because you will know exactly how a culture is being consumed on a periodic basis. So this is the intention of creating this, so that we can glean trends to make immediate interventions. Again, looking at a soft power fund to invest in ventures which are focused on cultural enterprises, because most of the companies are small in nature, they won't be able to go for an IPO. So there's a need for an intervention and for a fund to come in and support entrepreneurs. Again, there's a policy intervention that we want to suggest. Why can't Mudra give loans to entrepreneurs overseas to set up a small wage chain? He wants to sell pakodis outside New York Stock Exchange in a truck, and he wants $100,000. So where should he go? So if we have a refinancing scheme with a bank who has operations here, like Citibank has operations here. So if I have a refinancing scheme with Citibank, Mudra actually says that Citibank, you can go and finance it, we will refinance it. So you're actually thinking, going back to that, thinking outside the box, you're thinking about a startup India and a stand-up India outside of India too, because those people are also our constituents. We had the city of Statue of Unity recently. How about a city of unity? So Michael Porter came up with this concept of cluster theory, wherein there are different ways in which people come, cities come together. There's an ecosystem that's formed. And that ecosystem, whether it's fashion in Italy, so Milan, for example, that's a cluster. Silicon Valley is a cluster of startups. Like that, you have different clusters that are formed or formed. So there's a study being done about how those clusters act as a competitive advantage to that nation. So if you look at Bali, it's a very unique place. So there are beautiful beaches, it's a lovely culture, but the most important thing is there's craft, there's design, and there's craft and art, artists are there. So all three mingle together. And they're continuously, so the artist sits with the craftsman, the designer sits with the craftsman, so the craftsman does the traditional stuff, but also does contemporary fusion. So therefore, they're constantly evolving. So what we need is, we have thousands and thousands of villages which specialize in one particular textile, one special craft, across the country. That doesn't give you scale benefits. What we need is economies of scale. Right? So if we create a smart city, because this government is talking about smart cities, if we create a smart city wherein we invite all the artisans from all over India and give them land, give them home, give them infrastructure facilities, give them lathe machines, give them the economies of scale, then what happens is, and the artists and the designers also come, and it's closer to a port, the tourists come, the buyers come. And then you create a beautiful Bali, a beautiful cluster, and scale economics will happen. But one important thing is, Bali today actually makes craft, outsourced craft, for Sweden and Norwegian countries. Because they're so rich now, the craftsmen are also rich. They're very, so they've stopped doing their own craft. So just like somebody outsources software to India, the Norwegian countries are outsourcing their craft and asking the Bali craftsmen to make it and send it to them. So it's when you go to Norway and buy a craft, it will be saying it's Norwegian craft made in Bali. Very interesting. So think about it. West is developing, but just think about it, that India can actually become, after software, it can be a global manufacturing base for all the other countries, because we have the skills. If you see how, again, from a services point of view, how our NRIs have, do you know that we control almost 35% of the strategy market in on economics market in the US, in all the US top business schools and all that? Most of this are Indians in the academy, right? Wall Street is full of Indians. Silicon Valley is full of Indians, right? Singapore, we have construction workers. In the Middle East, we have nurses and service. So if you look at it, and all the lot of Fortune 500 companies now, the executives are all top executives are all Indians. Actually speaking, if you actually take a step back and look at it, we are doing something right. Across the spectrum, we are now creating clusters, and you know, there's a set of, when somebody wants to employ, they know that this is coming from our country, their employability is going up. So that's a kind of a cluster. And so therefore we need to recognize this and devise how do we leverage this. This is something which is, so here is the situation. After autonomous cars, after artificial intelligence, there's going to be huge job losses. In the next 10 years, we are going to see significant amount of job losses, both in financial industries, any menial task is going to be job loss, autonomous. So what happens is that Maslow's hierarchy or our purusharatha, wherein artha, creation of wealth, is no longer required because universal basic income, because you get a dole and you don't have to work. What happens then is that there would be a pressure for dharma, there would be pressure for kama, and there would be pressure on moksha. And who can service this? We can service this, because we need, the world needs more executive coaches, more arts, and more gurus. So, to be a Vishwa Guru is enough. Thank you.
Thank you, Kiranji. It's a very ambitious plan you've set forth for us. And I'm sure that there'll be some questions. And please ask him difficult questions, okay? Don't let him off easily. Because, I mean, my experience of people, who are entrepreneurs, businessmen, people from management, they're all, they're all great communicators, and they somehow try to enthuse you and draft you or recruit you to their almost grandiose plans and ambitions, okay? So, I don't mean to undermine or deflate my own introduction of you. But my point is, I invite all of you to engage critically with this presentation, and let's ask Kiranji, our distinguished lecture series first speaker, some questions. And also, if the tea has come, I suppose this is a good time. We're waiting for some tea also to bulk up the spirits, but आप कुछ कहेंगे? कुछ थोड़ा अपना परिचय देकर के इंट्रोड्यूस करके.
नमस्कार, डॉक्टर दिव्य सतन, myself assistant professor in the Department of Science and Technology. First of all, I would like to thank you for being here. SSC, you are talking about culture. You are talking about civilization, and you are talking about craft and how by cultures and by looking into our traditional and conventional sources, India can become a soft power, and then ultimately the goal which we are talking about visual. My queries and question is, because so far as I understand, this your whole presentation is about your the institution you are working, or the way and the method you are doing for the path of development of India from the traditional society to the digital. Belonging to a rural areas, my submission is what I have witnessed, the cultures, the old traditions, the craft which we have witnessed in rural areas. For example,
can I please request you to attend to the question? Thank you.
as I'm saying that I'm belonging to a rural area, what I haven't witnessed, ki the rich folk bhi hai, the art bhi hai, the craft bhi hai, and the particularly one thing which every village hai, you are also saying and we have been also witnessed, that is in a vanquished stage. Because of the authority of the governments in power, because of the economical aspect also. What I have seen with the emergence of the, this thermal, the plastic culture, Chalasan. So what I have seen, I am belonging to Mandi.
What is the question, please?
My question is ki how the things which have been belong to rural areas in the form of art, culture, they are in the stage of little bit, nothing is left. Vanishing stage. How we can restore them? Because that is very important to preserve our culture, to art and to the heritage which we are carrying.
Okay.
Say, society hai,
good. Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Saglani. So, on the one hand, if I rephrase the question, Kiranji, we are talking about enhancing India's cultural, whatever, presence in the world and soft power. But the ground reality is that our culture, especially in rural areas, is not only endangered, it is practically vanishing.
And that's precisely, I agree with you. The biggest trend today is amongst the millennials, is what is known as conscious consumption. So they don't want to consume anything which is bought by large companies. Their consumption has to have meaning. So recently, somebody tweeted an image of a craft product called Sattva. And they are writing it clearly, saying that purchasing this garment will save a village. So this is the biggest trend globally amongst the millennials, that they want to consume something which is craft. So therefore, it is a very important opportunity for us to revive all that you are saying about.
Exactly. But if I might just interject. No, one second. The how is coming. See, as I see it, he's saying there is a demand globally for authentic products and products which are virtuous. They'll say, no animal has been slaughtered in this, no animal testing, or organic, or no pesticides. So, there is a demand. But the real, you have to link it. The other side is, in our own villages, things are dying. Because they are not conscious consumers. In fact, I think the rapacity, and millennia long suppressed, desire for consuming objects has made people very blind to what they are losing. So, how are you going to link the two? In fact, if you've seen Bodhana Traffic Jam, the idea that came up was to create pottery and sell it on the webs of the middleman, the NGO could be removed. So I told Vivekji that pottery is not a very good product because when you ship it, it might break. So, how to bring these two together, the conscious consumer and, if not the unconscious, but at least the uncaring rural subaltern who's not interested in preserving what is actually around them, but is crazy about, advertised products and which are ruining through the use of plastic and etc. their own rural environment, which you see to some extent in Shimla as well.
Thank you. No, there's no single magical solution to this. Basically,
no,
it's
no
like
plastic. Okay, no plastic.
Plastic is right there.
Oh, don't look that side.
There's no single magical solution. Basically, once the income comes, One of the reasons for dying away is that they have not upgraded their skills, they're not able to invest in new technology, they're not able to get into new forms, which is why I quoted the example of Bali. The reason why Bali is very successful is because designers actually live in the village, live and give the latest designs, and then they don't tamper with the traditional. So that goes on. But they use that to again fuse it to contemporary form. So this is very important. So the entire revival of handicrafts and textiles can only happen in that kind of fashion. That's why I said the economies of scale and bringing it all together in one location would be a good start.
Exactly, but just to be a little argumentative, you know, look at Bali as a case, you know. Look at the, you know, Bali bombings as well. And the beaches in Bali have been invaded by these hungry Western tourists who are low end. I mean, they don't spend a lot of money. And, you know, sometimes the infestation is so, what you might call, annoying. There's no place to walk. There are rave parties, and the more interested culture tourists move to Ubud. I myself had that experience that, you know, the cheap properties lining the Bali beach, and you look at Hos Khas village, you look at, you know, Shapur Jat. So many of these properties have been taken over by, you know, these interests. And they are all projected as a magic bullet that, look, here's a way to do this. And I agree that, you know, in Bali now there's much more awareness. I'm not disagreeing with you, but I'm saying when we sort of valorize some of these and feel that they're going to solve our problems, don't you think sometimes they create other kinds of problems? Like, you know, one last example. If you go to Europe, any of the capitals of Europe in the summer, I went to Prague, I'll tell you, there are armies of tourists. I mean, when they start marching, there's no elbow room. I mean, I'm not kidding. Because the streets are narrow. It happens in Venice. You know, St. Marco's Square, which is a very large space, has no room. And when you, you know, go through the, you know, waterways and alleys of Venice. So, don't you think that this commercializing of culture, trying to leverage it economically, the moment it's profitable, you know, like vultures, these people are going to come, flock to these places, take them over, and this virtuous cycle that you are dreaming of and promoting may actually turn into a vicious cycle where there is this branding. The virtuous branding is actually sort of masking or hiding a very sad and brutal degradation of the local environment.
I think this was the case earlier. I think the awareness for the environment and the awareness is now at an all-time high. So, whatever growth and whatever protection that we talk about, that would be calibrated. I think the government policies would be that they would calibrate it. It won't, these kind of things would not happen.
So in other words, you also see a role for government as a interface or as a supervisory agency?
Oh yeah.
Or no, some no, regulatory authority,
of course,
yeah.
This idea of a cluster of all the villages, all the, you know, all the artisans coming and living. That is not possible in a private nation. That has to be a government. It has to be led by the government. The department actually talked about three or four clusters, but they didn't think of it. They just felt it like the garment or the carpet cluster. But you have to add the element of a port. You have to add the element of tourism. And you have to add the element of artists, like Ubud, like 30 years onwards you had, you know, writers festival. You had that culture of art being there, and designers. Bali, one of the examples is because villas were created, and therefore architects settled globally. They settled there, and they worked, and therefore they gave them. All this transformation is just 30 years ago, in front of our eyes. So, I'm pretty certain that if you think of it this way and create a city, a craft city cluster, why? Because you're not talking about completely uprooting them. So they're sending a few members of the family. So there's again that village is also going to be connected. So therefore, it means that.
Okay, I see a hand up there. You're
asking
various clusters around the
country. Yeah, so one large city.
That's not one large city, I think different cities around the country. It can't be one city, you know.
No,
it's not one city, but see, we've already experimented with something like Cholamandalam village. Are you sure? I'm asking for black tea, brown tea, green tea, coffee, black tea. Maybe. Good. No, so one cluster or another cluster, I don't think biscuits, black tea, dusra ka black tea. We'll come back to this idea. Let's take in a few more questions. Yes, please say a word about yourself. I know that. Okay, but go ahead.
Hello, everybody. I'm Karun. I'm doing my PhD from Punjab University, Chandigarh. So my question is related to the presentation that you showed about the cuisine, how it is presented in that restaurant in London. And you called it thinking out of the box. I really feel I would
maybe thinking out of the dish.
With due respect to your concern for India, I want to register my disagreement with that. Because that is not the way of Indian way of treating our food. We have a proper decorum. And then you said consumption of culture. I agreed with you in that way. Culture can be consumed, but not Sanskriti. Professor Panjipe is there beside you. I think he can elaborate on that in a better way. Because Sanskriti, what I feel is some plus Kriti. What we do in our day-to-day life is a yoga of that. And it becomes an way later on, an abhuti. And from your talk, what I could discern is that you seem to be concerned much more about global NRI, when it's called global NRI as our own.
No, but this is good enough. We'll come back to that global business. Thank you.
Yeah. So, like I mentioned, that was just the idea that somebody thought of it as a problem of the box. I'm not saying that you eat like that. So please, that's not at all my suggestion that we eat like that. From that little example of how he thought of going outside, it's just an example of how we can think outside the box. So to that extent, it's...
So don't take it literally. And to eat...
No.
Take it... I'm just joking.
I'm sensing the danger, actually.
No. He will answer. But I want to say one more little thing. To eat off the table, you have to pay a lot of money. So don't worry. We are not going to, eat off the table so quickly.
That's why if you see how I ended my presentation, eventually you've heard of this concept of American exceptionalism. American exceptionalism is a simple idea that their liberty, the freedom, and they have a role to play in the world. It's a positive assertion. It's not a jingoistic assertion. People genuinely believe that America has a role to play in the world. That's a belief. Based on their values and based on what they contribute. Our concept of Vishwa Guru is that we are meant to be the gurus for the world. We have to believe in that. Do you believe in that? I believe in that. So therefore, the Sanskrit that you are talking about will be learned only when we teach it. What we are trying to do is offer authentic wisdom. What the world has done is they came to us, they picked up, hey, this is yoga, or this is asana, let me take this asana from here, right? Let me take this, this is meditation, let me take this meditation. That looks nice, that's sustainability, that's craft, let me take that, right? They have done it without us offering it. They have done it and they are free to do it. It's a global marketplace, right? What we should do now is that look, what you're doing is fine, thank you very much for consuming, but here is how we should do it. Which is where your point of Sanskrit comes in. When we are offering the authentic thing, that comes in automatically.
So, okay, I just want to add a footnote. One second. You know, the two are not opposed. That's the point. Consuming culture and Sanskriti are not opposed. And I think before we can teach, we must practice. We'll come back to that later. Being a Jagat Guru is a very big thing. Pehle hum apne aap ko pehchane. So we'll come back to that. But so to come back to what you're saying, I agree with your idea of Sanskriti. And don't tell me that nobody in India has Sanskriti. We have it. We practice it. But now, how to present it to the world? And if you think that things will self-market, apne aap cheeze sabko samajh mein aa jayegi, ye nahi hoga. Hame apne aap ko prastut karne ki kala bhi seekhni padegi. And this is something we should not either undermine or denigrate. People who are trying to present our culture all over the world in a more positive way, we should be deeply grateful to them, because there are a million people who are trying to do the opposite. So, isliye main keh raha hu ki don't create a dichotomy between Sanskriti and consumption. Kahin to ek link bhi aati hai. Aur main aakhri ek cheez aapse kehna chah raha hu, because you're a serious student, isliye ki you see kya hota hai ki we don't like the market because we are academics. I'm sorry to say this. But tomorrow, suppose everybody told you your jobs are contractual, that if you have any skill you demonstrated in the real world, कितना मुश्किल है 10 रुपया भी कमाना. हम सरकारी नौकर हैं, इसलिए हमें बहुत आनंद आता है. हमारे कोई सचमुच स्किल होंगे ना, तो उसको टेस्ट भी करना चाहिए. तो ये थोड़ा आप सोचिए इसके बारे में. एंड मैंने किया है, इसलिए मैं कह रहा हूँ. यू नो, आप एनी हाउ वी वोंट गेट साइड ट्रैक. आई सॉ अ हैंड अप देयर. वन सेकंड. यस, स्टैंड अप, इंट्रोड्यूस योरसेल्फ ब्रीफली एंड देन आस्क योर क्वेश्चन.
I'm doing my PhD at Calcutta University. My question to you is that we have always projected to the world that India is a land of culture. Don't you think you are talking to project that as a market value? I agree with that, we can market all that. But if we constantly talk about culture, first we give them music, then we give them yoga, now then we give them pottery. Now the point is, when do we give them industry? And we come up as a power which they are afraid of. You know, America exceptionalism goes there, but at the end of the day, people are afraid of their guns.
Yes, yes.
Thank
you. So, one second, I will add just a footnote. You know, I think what she's saying is there's no soft power without hard power.
Exactly.
So, sometimes we keep talking about soft power. Does it mean it comes at the expense of our hard power?
Very, very well pointed. A lot of my friends who know my work and my constant talk about, they just dismiss it and say, talk about hardcore. But we must understand, my positioning is that I'm saying soft power to become an economic power. That's why I'm saying our culture is a resource. The moment you recognize it as a resource, that has to be leveraged. And there is money to be made, then your economic power is going to come. The global trends is that manufacturing is changing. China's has a huge manufacturing capacity, excess capacity. And robotics, automation, AI have come in a very big way, such that manufacturing itself is changing. Just to give an example, the Keds manufacturer, shoe manufacturer, it employs, say, 3,000 people in China. Now it's going back to Germany with 10 people or 20 people, because everything is automated. So, for us to think that industry, right, there is an industry, there's a plant, and there are jobs in the plant, this construct itself we need to relook at, rethink, because globally, this is changing. And it's changing into a situation wherein services are becoming more important. So everything is oriented. And even in service also, today you have a job, tomorrow you are not sure. Because if you are just into coding, for example, and tomorrow the computer is doing, AI is doing coding, and you don't have a job. So it's a state of flux that we are in, that we need to constantly learn new skills. But I completely agree with you that we have to be an economic power. We have to be a military power to protect our boundaries. And that's how Britain, Japan, that's how US, for example, US actually is a cultural superpower. People will wonder how the hell is US a cultural superpower? But actually, if you look at it, the books that you read, the movies that you watch, the music that you hear, the clothes that you wear, the burgers that you eat, right? Thought, word, and deed, everything is American. And all the companies are around us, whether it's Subway, McDonald's, Levi's, I mean, everything, right? This is a reality. So there, how did it start? The chicken or egg problem, right? So how did the company started, or it became a culture and then, I'm growing up, I want to go to US for education, I want to wear jeans. Those are aspirational values. So to define something and say that this is the starting point, I will do this and then linearly I will go and do that, may not be a good strategy. I went back to the global mega trends. Those trends are not my creation. The desire for craft is a pushback of Western consumption and destroying the environment. And then there's a realization that, hey, we should be doing this. Right? So that is an opportunity for me, because my economy is in the villages. So this is great opportunity for me to revive my villages.
See, in fact, I just want to come back to your question. We have to rethink what we mean by hard and soft. Like in classical Marxism, base and superstructure. We don't know what is the base and what is the superstructure anymore. If you think that the next war will be won by missiles, you might be mistaken. It might be won by computers and hackers who will hack into your security system, and your missile control can go haywire. What is China investing in today? They have the best hackers in the world. So really, though we may have the best programmers, who has the best hackers? So we have to rethink all this. And it's a two-way street. Culture can feed into the economy, and economy can feed into culture. And global superpowers require a convergence of three kinds of power: economic power, military power, and cultural power. Only then you become a superpower. Unfortunately or fortunately, Chinese culture is not that attractive, except Jackie Chan and Kung Fu and all that, you know? Our culture is very attractive.
One of the things Joseph Nye defines soft power on three axes. One, on culture. Second, on the political values of the country. Third is the foreign policy of the country. So he defines the combination of these three is the soft power. Now, not all countries, if you go back to my side, not all countries include China. China's political values not appreciated. Right? You have a political system which is top down, and nobody says that, okay. But today, Indian democracy is so vibrant, that people all over the world appreciate it. Our voting and elections are much better than the US of A. They still, don't have EVMs. So our democracy has been working perfectly fine. So our political values also we hold good. And our foreign policy, we are never aggressive. Right? So actually, we fit in all those things.
Okay, next.
Hello, sir. I am Anirudh Jana from University of Hyderabad, doing my PhD there. And I'm a millennial, so I'll take that
you're
statement of yours.
Millennial
only. So I'll take that statement of yours that conscious consumption as a compliment. So your presentation actually reminded me few concepts which I read in my masters, like Theodore Adam's idea of culture as industry, commodification of culture itself. So my question is in relation to that only, that this is something which is very fascinating, and I as a millennial actually looking for that. But at the same time, but at the same time I sense a certain kind of danger in commodifying or marketizing our culture. The danger which I am sensing that the authenticity and the sanctity of our ownness, of which we are practicing in our day-to-day life, might be compromised.
Look, see, commodification, commercialization. What about monetization? Are you against that also?
I am also against
that. So you want us to be very poor?
No.
No charge for anything. Everything is free.
Why I am asking that? Because the idea which Paranjab sir brought up, actually the Americanization of the whole culture, because we treat America just as a military power, but something which actually miss that America is America because of the marketization of the monetization of American culture. Because right from my shoes to my hats, whatever, it's from America only. So somewhere at the subconscious level...
You're saying you don't mind paying for American culture,
no.
But Indian culture should be free.
You know, what I'm saying that, at the same time, don't even think that at certain level we might be compromising with the authenticity and the aesthetic values which are, you know, which
yes.
We have
got
in
it, our religion. Got it.
Yeah. There's no... you're right, that could certainly happen. It's always waves, right? So it goes up and goes down and goes up and goes down. Their excessive consumptions then comes back and then they become simple, meaning this day. Then there's excessive consumption. So those are cycles. At this point in time, given our economic position that we are in, the need, China has lifted some 300 million people out of poverty, right? And 400 million from lower end of the poverty into middle class. That's the kind of scale that we have seen, 700 million. We need to do that. Our basic objective today is to bring our people from poverty. And one of the ways is this. At some point in time, there could be commodification,
The irony of the state of the affairs is that more than 65% of India's population are dependent on formal agricultural work, and we are not able to address their genuine issues. And just one week back, lakhs of farmers were in Delhi raising their issues, which are very common and genuine. But this is okay. As a millennial, I see a great future for this project. But at the same time, we have certain genuine issues which we cannot write off right away.
What you're saying is that, you know, we don't have time for all this. This is very fancy stuff. First, we must concentrate on our pressing issues. No, but again, I feel that you're creating an either-or situation. You can't do either-or. You need both and more. Anyhow, let's take some more questions. We are running out of time. One minute. I saw this hand first. Next, you. Go ahead. Yes.
Hello sir, my name is Devjani. I'm doing my MPhil from Jadavpur University. First of all, I would like to, Aniruddha, forgive me if I am misrepresenting you. I share his concerns as well in the sense of reification of culture and Walter Benjamin's work of art in the age of mechanical reproduction and all of that, but I'm not...
What is all of that? I don't think anybody understands these things.
No, but
A class with me, I will reinterpret the whole thing. Even this Theodor Adorno business, culture industry business, but ask me.
Absolutely.
I do this because I see them all as my students only, you know, so I'm constantly
But my question is concerning something very logistical. You were speaking about the AI age and the post-AI age, and you were speaking along the same lines as Yuval Harari does. And he says that in the AI age and post-AI age, because it will have access to the entire data that we can comprehend, it will be able to provide us with the music we like, with the stories we like want to read, with the recipes we want to know. So in such an age where every need is being satisfied by the AI reading us, why do you believe that something like this might work out?
Actually, that is precisely why I believe it. What will happen is, so if you just extend that, like, you know, you've read his book, so
Sapiens.
The third phase is the
data, fascism through data. Right?
Yeah.
That's what, so oligarchs of Google and all that, it's actually fascism.
Data fascism.
So, and the algorithms will predict whom you're going to marry or whether your marriage is a better choice than you yourself can, because they would have known your fiance's complete data in terms of all the choices. They would have known your choices, and they would actually merge these two and say that the predictability of your marriage surviving is much better or not better. So that's how it's going to be.
Can I just add something to that? In response to a few questions, you know. In fact, the kind of In fact, the kind of culture we have really not advertised that in the manner in which we should have. I'll give you an example. When Swami Chinmayanand, he was addressing to an American audience there, he said, one of the students, he just stood up, and he said, Swamiji, you are saying we should not be jealous of others. Why should we not be if he is doing some harm or something like that? Then what Swamiji said, you just see, what do you want in life? He said, success. He said, when you are jealous of someone or when you think something bad about someone, then you are not concentrating on your job. And that hampers your success. Because in order to be successful, you have to give full attention to that. And that, oh Swamiji, I never thought like that. And he was satisfied. What I'm trying to say, there are so many things in our culture. For example, nowadays we have started eating on table and chair, you know. But now there are so many Americans who have learned, Britishers who have learned, that sitting in that posture and eating, that digests your food.
Yes.
So if you explain them in a scientific manner, so many things, you know. If you explain them in a scientific manner, they are ready to learn. So I think one of the goals which you are trying to, so many things, I'm just giving these two examples, so many things, you know. So if we tell them in the scientific manner, I think there are so many things that
you can. Correct. But you know, coming back to this, this is not relevant to what you said, it seems. But yeah, I just want to sort of say one thing and then take a couple of questions and then you can have a final roundup. You know, I saw a film on the flight recently. It was based on a book by Malcolm Bradbury, and it's about people who burn books. Did you see that thing? It was, but it flopped. Anyhow, but there, these book burners, they have an AI partner. They don't have real partners. So you press a button and this, like your Siri becomes a real person. There are many films, you know, about AI, and they're going, see, what I'm trying to say is these two concerns are actually contradictory. One is very futuristic, and the other is grounded in the so-called present as well as peasant realities. And in between these two, you want to quash this kind of project. But what I'm trying to say, in both instances, there is such a deep craving at both ends of our spectrum for what we may call authentic experiences. All the more need for them when everything is artificial. Do you see what I'm trying to say? You want to hear a live chant or a live performance, not a TV. Why? Because you're looking for that aura, more authentic. That's where some of this comes in. To think that all culture will be, you might say, artificially generated and data-based would actually mean the end of the human condition as we know it. So that's a huge way up in the future, which we shouldn't worry about that much when there are so many data deprived amongst us, right? And again, I don't also feel that the data deprived should also be condemned to be crafts, you know. And the data rich should be the consumers of the crafts that the data deprived create. So that's what I'm saying. Let's avoid the either or. But we'll take a couple of questions. Yeah, go ahead.
Mahatma Gandhi, school, बड़ी अंग्रेजी कमजोर है इसलिए आपकी बहुत सारी बातें हमको नहीं समझ में आई, लेकिन आपने बड़ी सुंदर कथा कही। मेरा कुछ प्रश्न तो नहीं है पर छोटी छोटी टिप्पणियाँ हैं। एक तो इन्होंने पूछ लिया कि कंज्यूमर आप कंजम्पशन ऑफ कल्चर पूछ लिया, कंजम्पशन ऑफ कल्चर को छोड़ देते हैं, हम थोड़ा फैक्ट पर बात करें। जैसे हर गाँव में जो लड़का है उसके हृदय में एक मुंबई जन्म ले चुका है, बहुत पहले से, और जो शहर में लड़का है उसके हृदय में एक अमेरिका में अमेरिका जन्म ले चुका है, सबकी इच्छा होती है, लेकिन कोई पैरामीटर दिखा रहे थे जहाँ अमेरिका को अपने जीरो अंक दिया है, वो समझ नहीं कि पैरामीटर क्या है, पर अमेरिका वाले कॉलम में जीरो दिखा रहे हैं, जबकि हमारी इच्छा है कि अगर आज अवसर मिले तो तुरंत अमेरिका फ्लाइट लेकर मैं पहुँच जाऊँगा। दूसरी चीज़ ये आपने लिखा कि विश्व गुरु, ये विश्व गुरु क्या है, कब हम थे, बीच में कब खत्म हुए, या भविष्य में कैसे विश्व गुरु होंगे, जबकि विश्व स्तर की कोई यूनिवर्सिटी भारत में नहीं है, जितने भी आर्टिकल पब्लिश हो रहे हैं स्तरीय नहीं है, ये मतलब जो ग्लोबल डेटा है उस स्तर में भी देखा जा सकता है, साइंस एजुकेशन यहाँ बहुत पुअर है, बहुत ही पुअर है पूरे भारत में डेटा के आधार पर कह रहा हूँ, तो किस मामले में हम विश्व गुरु हो जाएंगे। शिक्षा के स्तर पर सर जानते हैं, मतलब मैं भी RTI के थ्रू अध्ययन कर रहा हूँ, शिक्षा का स्तर बहुत नीचे गया है पिछले चार पाँच वर्षों में तो पूछिए ही नहीं, नियुक्तियाँ भी बंद है, फिर हम विश्व गुरु बने कैसे?
जी जी सर, थैंक यू। और एक दो प्रश्न। हाँ जी विशाल जी, आपको।
सर मैं बनारस से हूँ, तो जानना चाहता हूँ हैबर मास वाले स्टाइल में, जब विवेकानंद जी थे तो कहे कि उस वक्त से एक प्रोजेक्ट चल पड़ा स्पिरिचुअल पावर बनने, वो तो बने नहीं और अभी हो रहे हैं सॉफ्ट पावर। सवाल ये है कि ये सब मॉडल हमको बाहर से मिल रहे हैं, यदि हमको इकोनॉमी को ही बढ़ानी है और इसी धारा में चलते रहे तो दुनिया में सबसे फास्टेस्ट ग्रोइंग सेक्टर पोर्नोग्राफी का है, अश्लीलता के व्यापार, तो कुछ दिन के बाद हम उसको भी करने का सोच सकते हैं। That's all.
अच्छा, और एक दो प्रश्न from this side. Any of the fellows want to ask a question? Anita ji. हाँ जी, अनीता जी। आशुतोष जी, आप।
सर मेरा नाम अजय कुमार है, मैं यहीं पर फेलो हूँ संस्थान में, और आपके लेक्चर में मुझे बहुत सारा कंफ्यूजन मुझे लगा, बाकी लोगों को फंसता समझ में आया हूँ, और जो मैं मोटी मोटी बातें समझ पाया हूँ तो उसमें एक बात ये निकल के आई, कुछ फायदे की बात हो रही है फायदा ये जो इन्वेस्टमेंट कौन करेगा या कैसे कराया जाएगा, वो फायदा किसके लिए होगा। और दूसरी हमारे साथियों ने सवाल पूछ लिया विश्व गुरु की बात, ये बहुत अच्छी बात है कि हम विश्व गुरु थे और रहना भी चाहेंगे, और इसे मुझे कोई स्वीकार करने में हिचक नहीं होती है, बहुत सारा था हमारे पास, इतना बुरा भी नहीं था हमारे पास, लेकिन जो मैं इधर पढ़ रहा हूँ बहुत सारी चीज़ें, स्कूल बंद हो रहे हैं, स्कूल प्राइमरी स्कूल जिसमें यहाँ की भारत की जनता पढ़ती है, जनता के बच्चे पढ़ते हैं, गरीब बच्चे, यूनिवर्सिटियाँ बंद हो, मैं इस सरकार के दौरान की बात नहीं कर रहा हूँ, ये पहले से आ रहा है, बहुत पिछले 15-20 साल का मामला है, तो जो बंद हो रही चीज़ें ना, तो खुलेंगी सर कैसे, तो हम फिर कहाँ यहाँ तक पहुँचेंगे कैसे, ये दो तीन चीज़ें थी।
थैंक यू।
ये सेड द मोस्ट ऑफ व्हाट माय कंसर्न्स आर एज वेल, द आइडिया इज वेरी फैसिनेटिंग, एज एन एविड रीडर ऑफ उपनिषद्स एंड एंशिएंट टेक्स्ट आई गो थ्रू देम, एंड आई ऑल्सो फाइंड दैट वी हैड अ लॉट ऑफ विजडम इन आर टेक्स्ट, बट समहाउ द रोड मैप इज मिसिंग, नंबर वन। नंबर टू, द फर्टाइल कंडीशंस that possibly can take us to this area, that also do not seem to exist, or at least they are not visible to me. Okay. So unless creating those conditions, it seems a fanciful idea as of
now. Okay, 5G. Okay.
So my question is, like, has been discussed so much, but still I'll go back to it. I'm also from Varanasi, as he said. Ma'am is also here. So, like, my concern is, like, we are talking about culture.
We have, you know, we are Kashi cluster.
Yes, yeah, we have that, and we are proud of that as well. So, so my concern is, like, we are talking about promoting our arts and artifacts and handicrafts, right? So, Banarsi Sari has been in news internationally these days. But when you actually go and visit this Julaha, Ansari Julaha's Basti, they are in absolute abject condition. But they were not so before maybe 10 years back, when this so-called globalization and capitalization did not so happen. I don't know, I mean, the nexus between that. So so these objects are being, you know, sold outside as cultures of India. If you are getting married in your trousseau, you need to have a Banarsi sari kind of a thing. But then what has happened? You have erased and you have really kind of put the life of the actual workers in such abject condition. It's like what Slavoj Žižek talks about. You know, Starbucks says if you buy one cup of coffee, $1 goes to the poor children. It's something like that, you know. Mm-hmm. So we are in a kind of a dilemma, you know.
Okay. Anybody else? Any last? Yes. Go ahead.
I have done a very, you know, small experiment with my little experiences in the West. I mean, we always think the best representations from India come to art and culture, food, art and craft, music, dance. And we always try to present the best of our culture, the best, aesthetically best, not the real best. What is in the rural, what is in the village, what is being actually always produced, but then we take what is aesthetically can attract the Western consumers. Yeah? So we try to do, you know, some bag selling in a flea market. We bought some from the Bargaj market, and then we sat in a flea market, try to sell new bags, not old bags. And try to understand what color is going to really be attracted to German. Your in your column, German culture value is it's N, it is no.
Yeah.
A political value is yes. So we feel Germans are really, you know, they have a very, very, very bland kind of, you know, aesthetic value system. So can we also think of our, your Indic society is also thinking of something global aesthetic, because the food you eat in the West, the food we serve here, they're not be customizing. You know, the culture is always customized for a global audience. And then what everybody is probably putting here, that what happened to the rural, what happened to the, you know, the real. Yeah. So, but then we are ignoring because it is not catering to our audience that we are projecting. So can we also think of a global aesthetic, a global art? Because I don't think we have time, what he also presented, that we're lacking behind so back that it is very difficult to go at least at the standard of what West is or you know, the globe is going towards. Can we also think of, you know, buying a stole from Banaras, a plain one with a logo of something, you know, which is probably, you know, which will attract the West, not Indians. So can we also think of something like this? Is Indic society's thing?
Okay, last question.
I not question, but I also want, we are in an environmental crisis as well. How are you going to link both? And isn't what? How will soft power will actually also help preserve or take those drastic steps that we need to preserve our environment sustainability? You know, things like what you're saying, smart cities, etc. Are we going to see more deforestation or more pollution? So, you know, what are those things have you thought about?
Yeah, so just on that, our thought, even though the fact that today a lot of pollution has happened, and our thought in terms of simple thoughts of Ishwar, simple thoughts of Pancha Mahayana, these are very, very powerful thoughts. We live there. The Californians, when they segregate and say, oh, I want to do this and I separate this, and they're very careful and all that, that is nothing but the care, right? So it has to be a culture of care that has to come back into our society as a living living point. That has gone away. That has come back. But it can easily come back because it's ingrained in us. For them, it has come back because they could see the destruction that they have, what they have been. So the guilt is making them say, oh, but here our reverence makes a difference. Right? We rever. So if the reverence comes back, then there's a change. So in my opinion, there is a lot of what you're saying in terms of ecology, and there's deforestation, all that's happening. But we just have to bring back that culture of and living those values, and then the change will happen. Just to answer the point on Faida, this whole thing about is to the small, poor villager who is doing this craft. I mean, she has featured some, at least 25 villages where we are talking about how these crafts are made. Right? So there are, this whole thing is that, like I said, the consumer wants to save that person. So the fayda is to nobody else but that person. Yes, what she has been talking about in terms of the middlemen taking away, those are not restricted to culture alone. That's a general problem on economy and commerce, that there'll always be people trying to take advantage of. So we are not sitting in moral classes here in terms of, you know, some people should take, should not take. Those are not. We are just saying that let's recognize this as a resource and let's see how this recognition can benefit those villages. This is primarily about that. And the last question, I couldn't really get it, maybe you should.
Okay. Well, you know, I'm not going to go into that, but it was an, for me, this has been an experiment. The experiment for me has been to bring somebody, you know, from another universe of meaning into our academic, you might say, cozy nest. I call it a cozy nest, you know. And it's a nest in which ek to fayda sab samajhte hain. Sarkari naukri kaise mile? Iske liye kuch jyada chinta ya chintan ki avashyakta nahi hai. Uske baad har ek fayde pe hum prashna chinh uthate hain. Ye fayda agar ek baar ye fayda mujhe hasil ho, to fir har dusre fayde par main saavdhan, saavdhan kar sakta hun, kyunki main hi wo protector ban gaya us vyavastha ka. Aise mujhe kabhi kabhi lagne lagta hai. मैं किसी खास यहाँ व्यक्ति विशेष के बारे में बिल्कुल नहीं कह रहा, लेकिन all I'm trying to say is कि ये एक हमारे लिए प्रयोग रहा है कि हम इसी एकेडमिक डिस्कोर्स के कूप मंडूक के जैसे उसी कुएं में कूद कूद के, एक कोई हाबरमास कहेगा तो कोई वाल्टर बेंजामिन कहेगा, तो कोई डेरिडा कहेगा, तो कोई वो एडोर्नो की बात करेगा. सो वी आर, हम अपने ही चक्रव्यूह में फंसे हैं और एक अजीब आत्मरति में हम नहीं, एक मैं कहना चाह रहा हूँ, और दुनिया में क्या हो रहा है, what is happening in the world, you see, we are not aware beyond a point and we don't care, and none of our ideas, hardly any of our ideas is really being tested. Nobody will spend one rupee on some of your ideas. I'm just saying, उसको यहीं चलेगा, ये academic circles में ये बातें चलेंगी. So this is something for us to think about. And I'm not making a judgment. I'm only saying that two points of view emerged in today's discussion for me. And the bridge between them was not visible, was not, you know, needs to be made. And all I can say is nobody's right or wrong. Both sides are sincere. I really feel there's deep sincerity on both sides. I think we need to talk some more. And I think ideas also need to be tested, really. And you talked about the falling standards. I completely agree. We don't have one peer-reviewed journal in India. Hardly any. In social studies, we do. In humanities, I don't know a single one. You know? So when we are not peer-reviewing our own work, you know, how are we testing our ideas? So I agree that the, you know, one thing that I feel everybody felt uncomfortable with is the idea of the Vishwaguru, because we are very far from that. And in fact, I feel that even aesthetics, which you mentioned, you know, you go to Sri Lanka, Nini is from Sri Lanka, I don't know if she's here, but the homes in Sri Lanka are 100 times more beautiful than our homes. You go and see how they've integrated plants and water. Look at our hideous architecture. You know, look at Ubud. Hindu culture, so to speak, is far more beautiful in Bali than almost any part of India. So we are sitting on a destroyed civilization. Usko hum kaise? So it's a very big task. Uska punarjagaran, uska jirnodharan kaise kiya jaye? It's a very big task. But the only thing I want to say, see, you mentioned the culture of care. I think we are living in a culture of callousness, and we have developed a beautiful schizophrenic ability you know, even to show our reverence in a very callous way by being extremely violent to people whom we think do not revere the things we revere. So, you know, we are in a state of crisis, but please remember the word crisis itself, okay? It's a critical point, it's a turning point. Toh mariz mar bhi sakta hai yahan se. Yeah, crisis can turn into a huge opportunity. And I want to end on a positive note that I really appreciate all the concerns that people have. Many of our people have actually faced these things. They don't, unke liye padhi hui cheez nahi, wo gaon se aate, unhone dekha hai, gaon mein kya halat hai, hai na? Aur jaise aap keh rahe hain, school, yahan bhi Himachal mein sab English medium school mein jaate hain. State schools band ho rahe hain, koi chhatra nahi ja rahe hain. So they're in the middle of these crises. But in many ways, as I think, this is an incredible time in India, incredible opportunity. You know, how many people have exited from the poverty, below the poverty line in India? It's unprecedented. So after China, it's India. In fact, the largest country of poorer people is Nigeria, not India anymore. So I think something is going on and we are not able to, you know, cross the T's and dot the I's as yet. Aise mujhe lag raha hai ke jaise kabhi kabhi dark room mein, I'll end with this photographic image because Walter Benjamin has also talked so much about it. Because photography was the defining art of modernity. And Heidegger also, you know, picked that up. So it, you know, wo dark room mein when you of course, we are no longer in the analog world. So even photography now is obsolete. We are in a digital world. So there's no dark room. Jahan pe wo tasveer ubhar ke aati hai. But I'm using that bygone metaphor that something is emerging. We don't know whether it's a Frankenstein or whether it's a Mona Lisa, you know. So we are at a very interesting time historically. And I simply like to say ke, आज हमने कुछ एक झलक देखी है शायद वी सीन एन आई लैश और एन आई मर्जिंग फ्रॉम वन साइड ऑफ आवर डिस्कर्सिव स्पेक्ट्रम व्हिच यू प्रेजेंटेड टू अस यू नो इंक्लूडिंग द फैंसी गैस्ट्रोनॉमिक परफॉर्मेंस दैट वी सॉ यू नो बाय ए माइस्ट्रो बाय एन इम्प्रेसारियो थिंक यू सॉ दैट एंड देन वी आल्सो सीन समथिंग इमर्जिंग फ्रॉम द सोइल ऑफ आवर लैंड in that same dark room as we are shaking our silver, you know, and it's a plate and waiting for the image to emerge. And we've seen some terrible scar on the face of, so to speak, Mother India, if I may say that as an image. So, isko hum kis tarah reconcile kare, we don't know yet, okay? But I think that making an attempt to do so, okay? ये भी शायद कुछ हद तक फायदेमंद हो सकता है सो विद दोज वर्ड्स आई थैंक ऑल ऑफ यू हैव अ वंडरफुल इवनिंग थैंक यू थैंक यू आई अप्रिशिएट यू बीइंग हियर थैंक यू